Most of the time when you hear people talk about big data, they're talking about it within the commercial setting about how businesses can use big data in advertising or marketing strategies. But one really important place that big data is also used is for consumers. What's funny about this is that, while the data is there and the algorithms are there, and the incredibly sophisticated processing is there, it's nearly invisible. The results are so clean. They give you just a little piece of information, but exactly what you need. What I want to do is show you some common applications of big data for consumers that you may be using already without being aware of the sophistication of the big data analysis that's going into it. The first one is, if you have an Apple iPhone or iPad, is what Siri can do. For instance, aside from saying what's the weather like, and Siri actually knows what it is you mean, and where you are, and what time you're talking about, it can do things like look for restaurants of a particular kind of food and see if they have reservations available. It can do an enormous amount of things that requires the recommendation of other people, awareness of your locations, awareness of the changes over time of what is most preferable for people. The next one, you might be familiar with recommendation engines. This is an idea of software that is able to make a specific suggestion to you. Here's a Spotify account, and Spotify knows what you listen to when you're on Spotify, and what you listen to all the way through, what you add to your playlist, what you skip through, and it's able to make specific suggestions to help you find new artists that you wouldn't otherwise know about. Similarly, Amazon.com makes recommendations for books. For instance, here's a book, Principles of Big Data, by Jules Berman, and if you scroll down, you'll see that they have a list of other books that are recommended. This is generated by Amazon's recommendation engine, and you see several other books on big data, and in fact, it's a great list. It's the same general principle here. A lot of people use Netflix to get movies. Netflix makes specific suggestions for other movies you might like. What's interesting is that a few years ago they had a major contest called the Netflix Prize where they wanted to see if anybody could improve the accuracy of their predictions, meaning would you actually like this? If they could improve those predictions by 10%, it was a $1 million prize, and it was incredibly sophisticated analysis that went into this, but the end result again is a very simple thing: you get recommended a handful of movies, and usually you pick one and you like it. So for consumers, big data plays an enormous role in providing valuable services, but again, with the irony that it operates invisibly by taking a huge amount of information from several different sources and distilling it into just two or three things that give you what you need. We saw that big data can provide important conveniences and functionality for consumers, but for the business world, big data is revolutionizing the way people do commerce. We will look at a few particular places where big data has proven to be particularly useful, or unusual, and interesting. The first thing we're going to do is look at the place where most people have encountered big data in commerce, and that's in the results for Google Ad searches. Whenever you search for something on Google or any other search engine, you type in your term. You're going to get the results that you want, but you're also going to get ads. You see here, for instance, on the top when you're searching for big data. There are three ads on the top, and there is a series of ads down the right side. Those ads are not placed at random. They're placed there because they are based first on the thing that you're currently searching for, but also based on what Google knows about you. You can see in the top right that someone has logged into his account, so Google is drawing on all of the things that he has searched for, and the other information it has about him, to try to place ads that it thinks he would be most likely to respond to. That's something it gets by having a very large amount of data available, to tailor things to be most applicable to the consumer. Another interesting place is what's called predictive marketing. This is when big data is used to help decide who the audience would be for something before they actually get there. This is trying to predict, for example, major life events, like for instance graduating, or getting married, or getting a new job, or having a child, or any number of events that are often associated with a whole series of commercial transactions. To do this, these companies can look at consumer behavior. They can look at how often you log on to their website. They can look at what credit cards you use. They can look at how often you look at particular items before moving on to something else. They can look at whether you've applied for an account at their organization. They can make a huge amount of information that they already have available to them. Similarly, they can use demographic information. This can include things like your age, your marital status, the number of children you have, your home address, how far you live from their store, your estimated salary, if you've moved recently, what credit cards you have, what websites you visit. All of this information is potentially available in one form or another to the company that's trying to make these predictions. Similarly, they can rely on additional purchase data. It's possible for the company to get information about your ethnicity, your job history, your magazine subscriptions, whether you've declared bankruptcy or been divorced, whether you've attended college, the kind of things you talk about online, and so on. There's an enormous amount of information here that again is potentially available. Using this kind of information, it is possible for a company to predict that you're about to buy a new house, and that when you buy a new house you make an enormous number of purchases, and so they can link into you before you start making the commitments to those. Another place we want to talk about big data is trying to predict trends. One of the really fascinating places for this is in fashion. The company Edit has actually received awards for their use of big data in predicting fashion trends. So they can actually tell retailers what the most popular colors and styles and brands are going to be, when they're going to be popular, and they can help them price them. Obviously, this kind of information is enormously important to the companies that are going to be selling these products, and Edit is able to do this through their reliance on big data. Finally, one of the interesting uses of big data in commerce is for fraud detection. It turns out that fraud is an enormous industry, that online retailers lose about $3.5 billion each year to online fraud, and insurance fraud, not counting health insurance, is estimated to be more than $40 billion per year. So fraud is a big issue. It turns out that there's a number of things that companies can do to lessen the prevalence of fraud, especially through online transactions. They can look at the point of sale. That specifically means, how are you making the purchase? Are you online and what website are you using? They can use geolocation. Where are you physically located in the world? They can look at the IP address. What computer are you using to access the website? They can look at the login time. Are you somehow making a purchase at 4 a.m. when you've never before done anything after 11 p.m.? Interestingly, they can also look at things like biometrics. For instance, the way that people move their mouse, or the time they take between pressing keys on the computer, are distinctive measurements of people. A lot of this was made possible because of the particular details and the patterns that they have in their extraordinarily large data set, let them recognize these anomalies as potential fraud. We have looked at the role that big data can play in individual people's lives as well as in businesses. We also want to look very quickly at how big data has been revolutionizing aspects of scholarship and research. There are a few interesting examples of where big data has influenced scientific progress. The first one we want to look at is Google Flu Trends, where they were able to find that search patterns for flu-related words were actually able to identify outbreaks of the flu in the United States much faster than the research that the Center for Disease Control could do. Similarly, a more recent project found that Wikipedia searches could identify them with even greater accuracy. Psychological research has also been influenced through big data. In 2013, a paper published about personalities in the United States was able to identify clusters of personalities in regions where we have the Midwestern friendly and conventional region, the Western relaxed and creative region, and a Northeastern and somewhat Southern temperamental and uninhibited region. This is not based on simply how do you feel about the places, but this is published in a journal from the American Psychological Association, a very high-quality psychological research. Similarly, another group of researchers created an application on Facebook that used a scientifically valid measure of personality. They collected data from several hundred thousand respondents. And by combining those with the patterns of likes that each of those people had on Facebook to give a surprisingly accurate evaluation of what your personality would be. Finally, the Google Books Project. For the last few years, Google has been scanning books that were published over the last few hundred years. They currently have over 30 million books that they have scanned, they make them digitally accessible, and that allows people in digital humanities to look at the changes in word usage over time. There's some interesting things. For instance, we have the last 208 years of the prevalence of the word math, arithmetic, and algebra. The term arithmetic shows a strong spike in the 20s and 30s, but it decreases over time. Whereas the word math has increased over the last 50 to 60 years, with a peak right around year 2000. These are just some possible examples of what can be done, but the idea here is that big data, with both the volume of information that's available, the variety of information that's able to be combined, and with the velocity, especially with things like the flu trends, where things are changing constantly, all of these are able to make good use of big data for scientific research and advancement. It's an exciting time to see what's happening, and to see what will happen in the near future.